you are with us, you are guiding us, you are blessing us, and that you want to assure us that you will never leave us. Father, we thank you for this privilege to be able to gather together like this. Lord, I take this time to thank you for PYC people. Your Holy Spirit has made all of this possible. And Lord, we cannot take it lightly or ignore any of this. Because Father, you have wonderfully, magnificently, powerfully gifted this to us. And so this morning, Lord, I lift your holy name on high for gathering your sons and daughters who desire to know you more and who desire to seek a deeper relationship with the Lord. Father, it is my humble prayer that you may speak to us loudly and clearly. It is my prayer that your words may be very deep-seated into our hearts. That as we study the word together and understand the purpose and power of prayer, may you change us to be able to understand our desperate need of Christ in our lives. Father, please help us now as we study. May we only be guided by the Holy Spirit. May our flesh not take control of what we do, but may only Jesus be magnified and uplifted in everything that happens in this place. I submit to you our experience of studying the Bible together about prayer. May you help us to see, Lord, what we cannot see with our eyes at this moment. Please help us to see the deeper things about God and change us completely in the process is what we humbly and anxiously aim for. Bless us all that we may have a wonderful experience with you. O Holy Spirit, teach us what it means to pray. And I pray that by the time we are done in our discussions here, may you so possess each and every brother and sister of mine here that they all may go out with a deep hungering desire to know God and God alone. This is our prayer, Father. We beg for your mercy, the cleansing of our sins, and the empowerment of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So good morning once again.
Good morning.
Thank you. I can very safely say I do not know any of you. And that is a good thing. I have the privilege to make new friends this few days that we are together. I'd like to first ask all of you, how many of you believe in prayer? Some of you believe in prayer, okay. The rest of you are here to learn maybe about prayer. You'd like to know some deeper details about prayer. You'd like to know how to pray. That's an interesting thought. How is it that we should actually be praying? Somebody is asking the question, what should we be praying for? And what should be our heart's desire? What should be the condition of our life when we're actually praying? In this first session, I would like to keep it very simple. We are, by the way, I suggest this to you, to be ready. You will have to prepare a pen or a pencil and a notebook. You cannot survive without that. You will really need to take down notes. If you have your cell phones, I give you the liberty to use them. Not to text, but to take down notes. If you're texting what I'm telling you to someone, then all the best. I am with you. I will help you text that. Okay. But I will suggest you please take down notes. My teacher tells me, he says, Ron, your smallest pencil is longer than your longest memory. Your smallest pencil is longer than your longest memory. Your memory, after certain years, it might lessen, but what you've written with your notes, on your pen or your notes, you can always come back to it after many years and still be refreshed and still be able to study it. So please, take all of that down. I would like you to be very prayerful as we spend time together, because I really don't like to talk much without referring back to the Bible always. And so I really enjoy when we are going deeper into the Bible. That's one of my greatest joys, when we are really deep into the Bible. So here you will
most probably learned two things, Bible study and prayer. There is a separate session for Bible study, but here we're going to study about prayer, but from the Bible. I'm not going to share my thoughts, I'm going to share how we can study about prayer from the Bible, and what does the Bible has to say about prayer. To begin with, I will simply take us all. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Luke. I want us to see, what did God have in mind when he was talking about prayer? If you have your Bibles, just turn with me to the book of Luke. There is a very interesting scenario there. I really enjoy this chapter a lot. Luke chapter 11. It has become one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. Luke is an interesting book. Luke is written by Dr. Luke. You know, these doctors like very fine details. And these doctors bring out some very neat and very beautiful ideas in the Bible. For instance, let me give you an example. When the birth of Jesus is recorded by the other gospel writers, they just talk about, you know, yeah, Jesus was born and Mary and Joseph and the story that surrounds. If you study Luke's account of the birth of Jesus, Luke will tell you some very weird things and you will wonder, what is he saying? For instance, Luke will tell you, the year that Jesus was born, Caesar Augustus raised the taxes in the place. And you're wondering, I don't care who raised taxes. Jesus was born, that's it. But Luke wants to give you these details, and then he tells you, so-and-so was governor and so was officer. But while we look at it and says, okay, I don't really need this. I just want to listen to the word of God. I want to just listen to the story of Jesus. But Luke gives these things because, friends, the day and age we're living in, many people just don't believe in the truthfulness of the Bible or in the existence of a God or whether Jesus actually lived upon this earth or not. Luke gives a beautiful historical description. So for anyone who wanted to see the birth of Jesus and the time they lived in, All they have to do today is to just go back to history books or even Google or Wikipedia or whatever source you are using and check the year. In which year did Caesar Augustus raise taxes? And immediately in the record books you see the birth and the life or the history of a person of the name of Jesus. So the Bible is very beautifully put together by the Holy Spirit, and it has some very deep things for us to appreciate. We're going to take a look at the book of Luke, chapter 11. And we're going to see something very wonderful. We're answering one simple question. What is up with prayer? What is it really about? What is really prayer? Take a look at Luke 11. We're reading verse 1. The Bible says, it came to pass that when Jesus was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us how to pray, as John also taught his disciples. So one of the disciples come to Jesus and say, Jesus, please teach us how to pray. What's the question? How, not what, who. Question is, teach us how to pray. In response to the question how to pray, Jesus begins to teach. Follow with me in verse 2. Jesus said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we also forgive those who have trespassed against us. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. What should be the next words?
You know the Lord's Prayer, right?
What should be the next words? For thine is the kingdom. But do you see that there? Those words are not there. Somebody says, Jesus did not finish the prayer. But notice, he stays there and notice the next thing he talks about. Are you still there in your Bibles? Honestly, some of your Bibles might have a heading for the next passage. Is there a heading you have for the next passage? For the next few verses, is there a subheading? Anyone in any of your Bibles? No one? Okay, my Bible has a heading. It says, a friend comes at midnight. Now notice, he's telling them how to pray and he's sharing the Lord's Prayer. We have not gone all the way to thy kingdom come, thy will be done. But notice the very, in the sharing of the Lord's Prayer, notice the next thing that Jesus says. Verse 5. He said to them, which of you shall have a friend Go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine has come to me on his journey. I have nothing to set before him. And he will answer from within and say, do not trouble me. The door is shut. My children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give to you. You are there? Verse 8. I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. Interesting story. They are asking Jesus, teach us how to pray. So Jesus begins to teach them how to pray. Our Father which art in heaven, he goes all the way down in verse 4, he ends with, but deliver us from evil. And right after that, immediately he starts sharing a story. He says, by the way, a friend comes in the middle of the night and says, I want bread. The other friend from the inside says, ah, don't disturb me, I'm asleep, my children are sleeping, don't disturb me right now. But he says, he would not give him because he's sleeping, but because the friend is persistent, some translations use that word persistence. He says, because he is persistent, the friend will get up and give him as much as he needs. Now friends, listen to what Jesus is really sharing. This is also a tip in Bible study, okay? If you're taking notes, you want to write this down. Whenever you are studying the Bible, okay, and you want to study, for instance, you're taking a look at the Lord's Prayer. Ah, Luke 11 is talking about the Lord's Prayer. If somebody asks you, where is the Lord's Prayer? You will quickly take them to Luke 11. But friends, if you really want to study what the Bible passage is really talking about, don't just study that one verse or a few verses. Learn to study the whole chapter and pray to God to show you what it is that he is really expressing in the Bible. In fact, Sister White says, I believe in the book Steps to Christ, she says, we should never open our Bibles without praying. Did you listen to that? Sometimes we feel, I think I should read the Bible. So we just start opening and reading the Bible. It's not safe, she says that. We should never study the Bible without praying. Lord, I'm about to read the Bible. Please teach me the things you want to teach me through this Bible study. So I encourage you, learn to study the whole chapter. If you don't understand what's happening in that chapter, read the chapter before, read the chapter after. The study of the Bible will take time, but it will benefit you a lot. Let's go. As we study what Jesus is saying, he's sharing the Lord's Prayer. Immediately while sharing the Lord's Prayer, he begins to say, by the way, let me tell you a story. A friend comes at night, asks his friends for food. He says, no, but I am sleeping. My children are sleeping. I cannot give you. But because the friend is persistent, in Tagalog, there is an interesting word for people who are persistent. Can you give me a word? People who are persistent. In Tagalog, not in English. In Tagalog. Is there another word? What else? I like that one. You know, some people, they want something and they will not leave you. They will keep coming and, you know, keep asking. And sometimes you feel like they're troubling you, but they are not ashamed. They keep coming, yeah? You have people like that, friends like that?
Okay, you have friends like that.
Notice, I really want us to see what Jesus is really sharing about prayer. He says, this is how you pray, and he gives the structure and the study of the Lord's Prayer. It's a beautiful study to take, but that's not what we're taking right now. He shares the Lord's Prayer, and immediately he says, by the way, praying is not about you having some form. Okay, I need to do this, and then I need to do this in prayer, and then I need to do this. It is not about a structure that you have to follow. He says, more importantly, praying is not just about praying. Praying is about you staying persistent in prayer. My friend used the word makulin. You have to be makulin in prayer. You have to keep coming to the Lord. Keep coming to the Lord. Keep coming to the Lord. Many people, listen to me carefully, I've been in that condition. Many people have come. And they'll attend meetings like this, and they'll attend youth conferences or Bible camps or many other religious activities. Oh wow, I'm so blessed. I want to pray to God. So they go home. They they pray for one next 1 week, they pray so diligently. And the week after, they're still praying, but the time of their prayer lessens. And as the days go by, the time lessens and lessens. Can you relate to what I'm saying? And so the desire to pray and the desire to talk, it all grows up. So Jesus says, I'm telling you about prayer, but what I really want to emphasize is that don't just pray, remind yourself that I have to be mindful in prayer. I have to keep coming to the Lord. I have to be persistent and again and again. Jesus, in other words, is saying prayer is not about words. Prayer is about your persistence. And those who persist with God in prayer, they have an amazing, rich blessing in store for them. Now, listen carefully. Listen carefully. Now we're going to mix. In fact, I'm just summarizing in this first discussion, I'm just summarizing the whole discussion on prayer. Luke 11 summarizes the whole object of prayer. Let's go. Luke 11 and now verse 9. Now you see what is happening is, notice. Firstly, what Jesus is doing is, he is comparing. Are you there? Jesus compares. He says, some of you will go to a friend in the middle of the night, and you will ask him something, and the friend will say, I'm too sleepy. Jesus is creating a contrast. He says, when you pray, you're not just like praying to a friend who you think you are going to disturb. He tells us in the Bible that our God neither sleeps nor slumbers. So whenever you go to him, don't think, it's too late, I don't think I should disturb God at this time. Don't ever think that. Because the Bible told me he neither sleeps nor slumbers. In fact, he's just waiting there for somebody to actually pray. And during the day, you had no time. You were so busy, schoolwork, friends, and most of the day you spent eating, yeah? So yeah, some of you agree. You are eating and drinking and whatnot, so you have no time for God. So God is at least expecting, at least at night, but you get so tired when you come to God at night, how do you pray? And so God is teaching us here something wonderful. He says it is about persistence. And he compares, he says a friend will be tired and a friend might refuse you, but he says God is waiting to hear from you. God will not say, I'm sleeping, don't disturb me. God will say, talk to me a little bit more. So I want us to first understand what really is prayer all about. It is not just about us knowing how to pray and going through the structure of prayer. It is about us knowing that God is not just asking me to pray. He's asking me to stay persistent, to stay mindful in prayer. We have learned something. Now, in this context of prayer, now observe. We are going one thing after, because Jesus is sharing all of this in order. Luke 11 is a sermon. I learned from one scholar who said that the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they are not books in the Bible, they are sermons in the Bible. Are you there? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are sermons. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are four different preachers who are preaching four different sermons about Jesus. Luke 11, Jesus is sermon is being preached, and as a sermon builds up and it's all connected, in the same way Jesus also is preaching a sermon that is all connected. The theme of the sermon is how to pray, but Jesus is giving us the deep details and the deepness of what it means to pray and what is prayer all about. So first he says pray, but don't just pray, learn to be persistent. Now notice, still talking about prayer, notice what he says in verse 9. I say to you, ask and it will be. No. See, pause. We've lost. We don't know what this text means. Because we like to read, okay, ask and it shall be given to you, seek you will find, and knock and it will go. Okay. I know that this is a very old text. I've tried it, it doesn't work. Anyone here who's done that? Okay. I've tried asking, seek, and it doesn't work. You know why? You did not read the whole chapter. Follow me carefully, okay? I don't want to lose you. Jesus says, pray. Don't just pray. Persist. Is there a chalk here? I would like to write this stuff down so I maybe at least remember these things. Okay, my handwriting is not good, so don't pay attention to the handwriting, okay? So first, what do you do? You do what? You pray. But Jesus says, don't just pray. What do you have to do?
Persist.
So you have to be muggled. But then he says, you what?
Seek.
And then when you what?
Then it will be given. What is our problem?
We'll ask, seek, knock. How long?
1 week, 2 weeks, maybe a month, 2 months.
Maybe we'll remember after 1 year.
Why should we go back, ask him, seek, and knock?
And then we stop again. Jesus says, you want. God has desired something for you, has planned something for you, and what you're asking, he wants to give you, but don't just ask, seek, knock. Learn to pray. But don't just pray about it. Learn to be persistent in prayer. When you pray persistently, whatever you ask, seek, knock, you're going to get. Are you beginning to see a clearer picture of what the Bible is saying? So it's not just me about asking, seeking, knocking. By the way, asking, seeking, knocking is all comprised in one word called ask. You ask, you see, and you knock. Are you right? So when we're asking, we're not just, you know, going on our knees and asking, Lord, this, and that, and give me this and that. No. When you're asking, asking also comprises of seeking. Seeking what? I go to the scriptures and I seek, what does God want for me? So I'm not just saying, Lord, give me this. I'm also seeking the scriptures, trying to see, is this really what God would want me to have? For instance, I start praying, Lord, I need a $200 million jet plane today. Lord, I ask, and I will persistently ask for the next 20 years. I need a $200 million jet today. And next week, God gives me a bicycle. What is this, Lord? I've been asking for a $200 million jet. You've given me a bicycle. What is this? You've not followed. Lord, why did you break this order? God is explaining to me, you don't just need to fly, you also need to stay healthy. So, cycle every day. You will still be able to go places, but you'll also stay healthy. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Now, there are people, listen to me carefully, there are people who have actually prayed for jet planes. I'll tell you the story of one person who is a missionary and who runs an aviation department under the Adventist Church. And he was sharing the story of his experience of how, because they were in the aviation ministry and they were flying from one place to another to take medical facilities to many places. No, it is a very powerful story. He said, I was praying to God, God, we need a plane for our ministry. And he says, I went out to buy a plane and I was only looking for a cheap plane that I can fix and do this and that with. And I looked at another plane, it was more expensive, but I was like, no, let me just get this one. And he says, I had the impression of God telling me, get the more expensive one, but I said, I think I should just get the cheap one, Lord, so that we don't spend much money. So said he, I said, I went ahead and got the cheap one, but then I ended up spending so much money to fix it that he spent more money than the other one that was a little bit more expensive. So God initially wanted him to actually get a more expensive airplane. Now to some that may seem like, wow, God wanted us to get a more expensive airplane. To some again, we always need to understand what God desires for us in the way He desires for us. One friend of mine was asking another friend of mine very recently. He says, what if I give you 1 million pesos today? What will you do? The friend says, by the way, what will you do? Give it to the ministry. Which ministry? Eating ministry. Which ministry?
It's like Voice of Youth.
Voice of Youth, not PYC. PYC also. Please give to PYC. Okay. Now, some people, listen to this carefully. One friend of mine asked another friend, what if I give you 1 million pesos today? You know what the friend replied? He says, I don't know. He says, that's why God does not give you 1 million pesos. Because you don't know what to do with it. He says, today, if you tell God, God, this is the plan, I desire to do this for you. And when you desire, you're praying about it. You're persistent about it. You're asking, seeking, knocking. And you've presented the plan. You've been asking the Lord. You've been seeking in the Bible. Is this what God really wants for me? And you then go back to knocking on His door in prayer. When you do that, by your actions, by what you do and what you say,
You are telling the Lord about your desire to pray, your desire to persist. When we do that, that's when we see things happening in our life. But this chapter is not over. This thing only gets more deeper. Take a look at it. Verse 10, Luke 11, verse 10. Everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. If a son, now notice, now he's changing his sermon a little bit. All of this is developing. I need you to pay attention to this. By the way, those of you who like to share, you can use this when you prepare a sermon. Your sermon has to build softly and then it has to get deeper and higher. So he says, guys, you know what? You want to know how to pray? This is how you pray. Don't just pray, persist, be muggled in. But then ask, seek, knock. When you ask, seek, knock, while you're praying and persisting, you will get what you want. But now he shifts a little bit of a direction in verse 11. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will you give him a stone? If he asks for a fish, will you give him a serpent instead of a fish? If he asks for an egg, will you offer him a scorpion? Somebody is saying, Jesus, what kind of a discussion is this? Egg, scorpion, fish, what is this? So he explains. Look at verse 13. If you, then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who... At this point, Luke chapter 11 has taken a whole different turn. And to emphasize prayer, I will stop at that particular verse. Pray, persist, ask, seek, knock. But then he says, wait a second. If your children ask, he says, for instance, verse 11, if they ask for bread, will you give a stone? If they ask for fish, will you give a serpent? He's saying, you ask for bread, you ask for fish, you ask for this, you ask for that. And if you ask these as parents, you will obviously give them good things, you don't give them bad things. Notice this. He says, if you know how to give good gifts, don't you know that your heavenly Father also wants to give you? Notice verse 13. If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the... Now notice, bread, fish, all of these things are on one side, and he says, I want to give you what? What's the word there? If you then being evil know how to give good gifts to children, how much
more
will your heavenly Father? So you're asking for bread and fish, but I want to give you
more. Prayer is all about more. It's never about less. Are you there? Prayer is always about more in my life.
And God is saying, you're only praying for bread and fish and all. He says, but that's not what the point is all about. He says, you're praying, Lord, help me get a good grade, and help me buy new clothes, and help me get friends, and help me, get this and get some money, and give me food. He's saying, you're saying all these things, but I want to give you more. And what is the more that he says? He says, I want to give you the Holy Spirit to who? To those who? He takes us back. Like a good preacher, he reviews and makes a point on what he has already preached. He says, if all of you will give good gifts to your children, don't you know I, as your heavenly Father, want to give you more? What do I want to give you? I want to give you the Holy Spirit, but it is only given to those who will ask. In other words, to those who will ask, to those who will seek, and to those who will not. In other words, if you ask, I want to give you the Holy Spirit, but friends, listen to this. In other words, while we are praying for this and that, have you ever prayed for this and that? Lord, I want this, and can you get me this? And it's good to be praying to God. But God is saying, what I really want to give you is the Holy Spirit. So friends, prayer then, above asking for anything else in your life, what you really need to be asking is for the Holy Spirit. You know what Sister White says? She says, when you ask the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes in your life, the Holy Spirit brings every other blessing along with Himself. So I'm praying for power. I'm praying for victory over sin. Lord, help me overcome my temptation. Lord, help me get this. And Lord, help me. And Jesus says, what we need to pray, Lord, I need your Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes, he will bring every other blessing with himself. In another quote, he says, the greatest gift that God can give you. In fact, he says, even God cannot give you a greater gift than the Holy Spirit. So what is prayer really? What is prayer really? Think with me very carefully. What is prayer really? Prayer is not just talking to God. We all know prayer is talking to God. We talk about this all the time. But prayer is not just about talking to God. It's about talking to God consistently. Persist not once in a while. All the time I need to be in conversation with God. But when I do come to him, I persistently, when I ask, seek, knock persistently, when I'm talking to him persistently, asking, seeking, knocking persistently, that's when he wants to really give me that which I'm asking. But above everything that I'm asking, he really wants to give me the Holy Spirit. Next question. Why does he really want me to have the Holy Spirit? Answer. Let me hear your thoughts. Why does God want you and me to have the Holy Spirit? Any ideas? Why would he want me to have the Holy Spirit? What's the purpose? Anyone? No ideas? Do you take part in the 7-7 prayer every day? You know you're praying for the Holy Spirit, right? Why are you praying when we don't know what we're praying for? Why do we need to pray to God to give us the Holy Spirit? And he says, I want to, did you notice? He doesn't say that, do this, he just says, if you ask, I want to really give it to you. I don't even want to hold it back. I want to give you the Holy Spirit. You begin to ask, why is he so anxious to give us the Holy Spirit? Because we are sinners. What's the connection there? The Holy Spirit will help us to overcome sin. Interesting. Somebody else? Any other idea? Why do we need the Holy Spirit? Why does God want to give us the Holy Spirit?
Because we draw our power as Christians from the Holy Spirit.
We draw our power from the Holy Spirit. Good. What else? So we need to be comforted. Is that why you're sending me the Holy Spirit? Why is he so anxious? Why is he so desirous to give me his Holy Spirit? What's up with that? Is it just because I should be able to overcome sin? Is it just because I need power in these last days? Is that why I need the Holy Spirit? Friends, you see, in the Garden of Eden, God created man. And God was with man every day in the Garden of Eden. Are we together there? But when man sinned, they had to be separated because Isaiah says, our sins separate us from God. Clear? So to fix that, God was trying to come back to man. God was trying to unite himself with man. Don't lose this. Don't lose this on me. My friends, from Genesis to Revelation, the theme of the Bible is exactly that. God wanting to be with his people always. So in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, he gives them the sanctuary. And the purpose of the sanctuary was to unite himself. He says in Exodus chapter 25, if you're taking notes, in Exodus 25 and verse 8, Exodus 25 and verse 8, God says, let them build me a sanctuary that I may dwell with them. What was the purpose of the sanctuary? God wants to be with his people. He wants to dwell with his people. But people still rejected the sanctuary of God. So in the New Testament, God sent his only son. His name was Jesus. He sends Jesus, and Jesus walks with man and talks with man and does miracles with man. He's preaching these beautiful sermons to man. And people did not like Jesus, and they nailed him to the cross. Again, what was the name of Jesus? In Matthew 1, when Mary's told you're going to have a child, his name will be Emmanuel, which means, oh, that's amazing. God with, see, since the Garden of Eden, he wants to be with us, yes? In the sanctuary, he says, I want to dwell with you. In Jesus, he says, I want, in fact, in Jesus, God really was able to fulfill the desire of him walking with us. So Jesus walked with us because God wanted to be with us. But notice the love of God, friends. When Jesus was nailed to the cross because of our sins, Jesus says, your sins have nailed me, but I love you so much. As I go, I will still send you the Holy Spirit. We've rejected God in the Garden of Eden. The Father was displaced. He sends his Son. The Son is rejected. Son says, I go, but I will send you the third person of the Godhead, who is the Holy Spirit. And he will be with you. He will guide you into all truth. Now, the words of Jesus. He will be with you. He will give you power. He'll help you overcome sin. He'll help you do that. But above all of these things, yes, he will help me overcome sin. Yes, I will receive power when he comes. But above everything, the Holy Spirit is given to me because God's desire is still the same. He still wants to be with you. That desire has not changed. That desire has not changed. Why he wants to give me the Holy Spirit is because he just wants to be with me. Is there somebody you love on this planet Earth? None of you love anyone? Do you love somebody on planet Earth?
Yes.
Do you have the desire to always be with them?
Yes.
See, many times we look at God in the Bible, he's some big king on some big throne and crown. I cannot relate to him. The Bible presents God not so many times as a king, but all the time as a lover. And friends, if we can learn to take a look at God as a lover, your life, I promise you, is going to change forevermore. That lover is saying, since the beginning, I just want to be with you. I just want to spend time with you. That's why I give my son to you. That's why you've ignored him and you've thrown him out, but I will still give you my Holy Spirit because I, God, just wants to be with you all the time because he loves you very, very much. And prayer then, listen to me carefully. Prayer is not about some servant begging from some master. Prayer is not about a subject begging from a king. Prayer is not about a student asking something from a teacher. Prayer is about a lover talking to another lover. If you have ever fallen in love, there are times, my friend, have you ever fallen in love? Yes, yes. There are times when you're texting and you text the whole night. Have you been there? Text the whole night. And the next morning you find yourself, the sun has come up, but you're still texting the same person. And you realize you're not tired. Neither were you sleepy, were you? Are you there? Because you enjoyed talking to the person, not because you were forced or somebody said, sit and text that person. You loved the person, you just wanted to spend more time with him. Now, pause. because you love the person, you did this act of love because you just want to spend more time with that person. Nobody had to force you to do this. Nobody had to compel you to do this. Hey, sit and do this. You know, this is a true story about a young man. Listen to me very clearly. It's a very true story. It happened back home in my country. One young man, very interesting, one young person spends the whole day with a lady that he loves, okay? Spends the whole, I don't exaggerate, he spends the whole day with this lady. Late at night he comes home, okay? And he goes and sits on the rooftop of the home. And as he sits on the rooftop, he begins to call the same lady. Are you there? They were together the whole day. And he comes and sits and he calls the lady. And late night, you know, they're talking. He realizes as he looks it up, oh, sun is coming up. So he was with her the whole day, talked to her the whole morning. When the sun came up, he realized, oh, it's morning. And that's when he went into his house to go to sleep. And after a few hours of sleep, he was ready to spend the next whole day with her again. And what, this is not a made up story, it's a true story. After one whole day, a whole night over the phone, only a few hours of sleep, he gets up, gets ready, and again he's ready to spend the whole day again with the lady. Sometimes you'll find two people talking, and you'll pass them by. Oh, hello, hello, okay, okay, and you go by. After 30 minutes, you come back. Huh? You're still there? You guys didn't move? Okay, you go by. After 5, 10 minutes or 30 minutes, you come back. You guys are still there? What are you talking about? Because when there is love, nobody has to tell you what to do. Are you there? And nobody has to force you to do anything. My friends, now listen to me carefully. If my handsome friend here, what's your name? Joseph. If Joseph here loves a lady, are you listening? He loves a lady. And he tells her, I love you, I care for you. I really care for you and I really love you. And I want to do this and that for you and I will go here and go there and whatever you say. By the way, can I borrow 50 pesos? Oh, lady, of course. Gives the 20 pesos. Joseph goes out, you know, spends. Comes back again. You know I love you, right? Yes, yes, yes. And you know I'll do anything for you, yes, yes, yes. You know, the whole night I was just thinking of you. You are so amazing. I really love you. By the way, can I borrow 20 pesos? Really? Sure, why not? 20 pesos. Joseph goes out again. Next day again. Ah, so good to see you. You know I love you, right? Yes. You know I'll do anything for you. You know that. Yeah, yeah, I know that. By the way, can I go with 20 again? Just 20. Thank you. Pretty soon, if you are the lady that Joseph is doing this to, what are you going to tell Joseph? Huh? No, say it, say it. I want to hear it. Yeah. Go for it. That even sounds scary. I don't even need translation. That sounds scary. That sounds like you want to die soon. Are you following? When you say you love someone, but you only go to them when you need something from them. And you're only talking to them, otherwise you don't text them unless you need something from them. Are you there? Some of us children have this bad habit of texting good things to our parents when we need something from them. Some people who are guilty are smiling. I love you, mommy and daddy. You know, I miss you so much. And then you make a heart, maybe a kiss and whatnot. You know, our hugs and kisses. By the way, when is my allowance coming? After a few months, mom and dad realize whenever you say, I love you, huh? What do you need? I want to ask you this. I want to seriously ask, very seriously ask you this.
think you will find out who they, what they really want? Yes. As humans, you can really find out like that, right?
Do you think God doesn't find out? Do you think God doesn't understand? God is not wise enough to understand? If we're always going to God, God, I need this, God, I need that, and then, and when God realizes, wait a second, you never talk about me. You're always talking about what you want.
But you say, you call yourself a Christian, you tell everyone, and you wear a t-shirt, it says, Jesus loves me, I love Jesus, or whatever. But
whenever you pray, yes, I'm not saying you don't pray, and you pray persistently, and you ask, seek, and knock, but all that you pray, persist, and ask, seek, knock, God, is about yourself. It's never about me. And in a relationship where you're always thinking about yourself and not about the other person, then you are in love with yourself, not the other person.
All of a sudden, this has become a relationship seminar. I thought we were talking about prayer.
But quite simply, I'm trying to help us understand this. If I only see, I need to ask you, you need to ask yourself this question as you leave this hall, as we take a break, I think it's about almost 1 hour. As you leave this hall, I want you to think through the rest of this day and through the rest of this experience of youth conference. When was the last time you came to God in prayer? Lord, I just wanted to talk to you today. That's it. Don't want you to bless me. Don't want to ask anything. I just wanted to spend time with you. That's it. I don't want you to do something great for me today. No, I just wanted to talk to you, Lord, today. That's it. Just wanted to be silent and hear what you wanted to tell me today. That's it. Don't help me on my exam. Don't help me get it. Those are good things to pray. But Lord, I want to set this time, a single, alone time, where I just want to be with you. That's it. Why? Because I love you, not because I want something from you. Are you there? And when we understand this about prayer, my friends, your life will change completely. But you need to understand, no one can be forced to get there. You have to love God to do this. And friends, if you, like my brother Joseph, only goes to friends asking and asking and asking for this and that, immediately that friend realizes he doesn't want me, he wants the things I'm giving them. Are you there? God immediately realizes they don't want the God, they want God's blessings. Friends, understand this and write this down, not on that paper, but on your heart. Prayer is not about blessings. Prayer is about God. And when you understand, when I come to God in prayer, I am not seeking a blessing. I come seeking God. That's what prayer is about. God, today I want you in my life. I don't want anything else. I've had this, I have that, I have clothes, I have luxury, I have a place to sleep, I have food to eat, I have friends, I have everything, Lord, but today I need you. That's what I want today. That's what our prayer is. Then two lovers are beginning to talk. Then two lovers are actually talking. Where I don't just come to you to try and be good to you, because at the end of the conversation I will ask you for something. God, the Bible says he knows the end from the beginning. So when you're about to say amen, he already knows what's up in your mind. So friends, I want us to understand this as I make a few points in our as we close. If you have your Bibles, go with me to Deuteronomy, actually Hosea chapter 10. Or let's start with Deuteronomy chapter 4. And I want you to memorize this, okay? I want you to memorize these three texts that I'm going to give to you. This will help us in our understanding of prayer. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 29. Are you there? Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 29. Is everyone there? Okay, let's read. It says, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him. If you seek him with all thy heart and with all thy... God says you will find him. If you seek him, you are going to find him. Okay. Keep one finger on Deuteronomy 4:29 and take notes or whatever. Go to the next passage, Hosea chapter 10. The
the book of Hosea, chapter 10. Hosea, chapter 10, and verse 12. Hosea, chapter 10, and verse 12. Hosea 10, and verse 12. Are you there? Hosea, chapter 10. It comes after Daniel. After Daniel will come Hosea. Are you there? Okay, Hosea 10 and verse 12. Sow to yourself in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord. Now, Hosea is building up. What did Deuteronomy 4:29 say? Seek the Lord and you will find him. But he says, why you really need to seek the Lord is because your heart has become like a fallow ground. If you go outside here, especially on the ways where people walk all the time, for instance, if it's grass, and you see people always walking on that grass path every day, every day, every day. After a month or so, I guess, all the grass disappears. Yeah? And what appears is just that hard mud ground. You there? Hard mud ground. And people walk over it and it becomes so hard. You don't have to use a road roller to even it. No. You just had to walk on it every day, every day, every day. The soft ground which had grass has now become hard. Friends, when we neglect God and we walk every day in life with all the busyness of life, and you have school running over your heart, you have your relationships running over your heart, you have your own material things, your food, your clothing, your shelter, your finances, all of this is running over your heart. Your heart becomes like that hard, fallow ground. It becomes very hard. And God has a hard time penetrating your life. So Hosea says, break up your fallow ground. Which is why on a ground like that, the farmer will come and he will begin to use the tools to be able to dig up the soil. It's become so hard, so he has to break that ground. He has to break away the hardness so that the softness can come again. He says, break up your heart's fallow ground. It is time to seek the Lord. Pause. Now listen to me. Listen to me. Deuteronomy said, seek the Lord and you will what? Seek and what will happen? Seek and you will what? You will find. But Hosea says, it is time to seek the Lord, but what's the next word? Just one word. What's the word after? What's the word after Lord? Seek the Lord. What's the next word?
Till.
Okay. Hosea says seek, but seek till. In other words, seek until something is going to happen. But notice, seek till he will come and do what? Bring righteousness upon you. My friends, it's the same thought. Seek the Lord in prayer, you will find him. But keep seeking him persistently until you find him, until he comes to you. Friends, listen to me carefully. I want to assure you, after this prayer discussion, you would want to go back and spend more time with the Lord. You want to pray more to the Lord. You want to give more time in conversing. Not begging from God like a beggar, give me this, give me that. You want to talk to him like a lover. It doesn't have, prayer is serious. Don't think about it, maybe I have to write my prayer down before I pray to God. Come on, put that aside. Do you prepare a speech when you're going to talk to someone you love? You're going to talk to them, speak your heart out. This is who I am. Why do I have to... Wait. I did not put a comma there. You will be unhappy. Oh, the period is missing. I have to put the period. God, listen to me. God is not a grammar teacher. Are you there?
Yes.
God is not a grammar teacher. God wants to listen to a lover speak. When you speak to someone you love, I'm so sorry, by the way. I forgot to put and in the conversation. God says, I don't care. I don't care what language you use. You can speak 10 languages at the same time in prayer. I don't care as long as you talk to me. Speak in whatever language you feel like. I will listen because I understand all languages. So notice what he's saying. He's saying, seek the Lord until he comes. Friends, prayer is a battlefield. And in the few discussions I've ever seen, but I want to fit that in.
we're going to talk about the seriousness and the power of prayer. What can happen when we really pray? Because we need it in our battlefield today. Prayer is a battlefield. It will never be easy. Are you there listening to me? It will never be easy, and you will never have time to pray. You will have to make time to pray. Do you make time to breathe every day? Yes, you have to make time, yeah? But what if you don't have, I'm too busy today. Let me stop breathing for 1 hour. Can you do that? Because you're too busy. So Sister White says, prayer is the breath of the soul. If you want to stay alive in Christ, you have to keep praying. And my friends, it's going to be hard. You will face challenges. You will be attacked. But keep on praying until God comes in your life. Keep on seeking Him until God comes and knocks on your heart and saves you and delivers you and gives you victory over the struggles of life. Keep on seeking until He comes. Keep on seeking until He comes. Lastly, Isaiah 55. The book of Isaiah, chapter 55. Isaiah 55 and verse 6. Isaiah 55 and verse 6. Are you there?
Yes.
Isaiah 55 and verse 6. The Bible says, Isaiah 55, 6. Seek ye the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is. Now my friends, pay attention. Pay attention. Seek. If you seek, you will. But there is something very interesting that was mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy 4:29. Can you go back there if you still have your finger there? Deuteronomy 4:29. Somebody read out loud Deuteronomy 4:29. Somebody read it out loud. We're trying to wrap this up now. Deuteronomy 4:29. Somebody read that last text for us.
Seeking. That is called the close of probation. time comes, the Bible tells us, you will be praying, there's nobody to listen to your prayers. Probation is closed, Jesus is getting ready at that time to come and take his people. Friends, let us come seek the Lord, not his blessings. Let us come seek the giver, not the gifts. Let us come spend time with the Lord. Come talk to him. Don't prepare a fancy prayer. Don't make some big speech. Don't try to sound good. Come and open your heart to him. Honestly, he is anxious to hear from you today. What is prayer? It's about me talking to him. Talking to him persistently. Asking, seeking, knocking, not just for what I want, but above all, I want God in my life, which is why he wants to give me the Holy Spirit. When I have him, I have everything else. Let us learn, my friends, to fall in love with the Lord. And he has great and mighty things in store for us. Get ready for our next discussion. We're going to have some very powerful things to deal with in our second discussion in a few minutes. Let us pray as we close. Can we all stand? Bless you all, my